Hello students, this is Shweta Roy. This video is for chapter 5, part 2, history, crafts, industries and colonialism. In this video, we are going to discuss about the community of weavers, causes for the decline of the Indian handicrafts, establishment of cotton mills, the rise and development of modern industries. So these are some of the topics which we are going to discuss in this video. So we will start with the topic, the community of weavers. Weavers are actually the people who are skilled in the art of weaving. This profession was usually hereditary and it was taught by one generation to the next. Now the initial stage of cloth production was spinning and it was done mostly by the women. Charkha and takli was used in that. After thread was spun on the charkha, it was rolled on the takli. After that, the rolled thread was woven into cloth by the weaver. The work of weaving was done mostly by the men. Now, to meet the demands of colored cloth, the thread was dyed by the dyer or the rangrej. So rangrej used to dye the clothes. The chipigars were the people who specialized in block printing. Now the goods which were ready for being sold were first collected in a warehouse. And the warehouse was known as Aurang. Now in early 19th century, the four main regions of textile production in India were Bengal, Deccan in eastern Bengal, which is now in Bangladesh, Madras, Pondicherry and Nagapattinam on the Coromandel coast, and Patan, Ahmedabad, Surat in Gujarat. These were the four main regions of textile production. Now, what were the causes for the decline of the Indian handicrafts? Now, till the first half of the 18th century, there was a steady flow of Indian textile and spices in the British market. And they were often exchanged with precious gems, jewels and goods. Artisans were also supported by aristocratic class and jamindars. These jamindar and aristocratic classes used to share of the village land and agricultural produce in lieu of their service. Now the situation changed with the advent of British in India, and it was changed for peasants and artisans both. Now the peasants were forced to live on the mercy of moneylenders because they were overburdened with the taxes. Peasants now could not give the share of their produce to the artisans. Earlier they used to give the shares to the artisans, but it was not there now. Peasants were already overburdened with the taxes, and if they were unable to pay their tax, they were deprived of their land. So the condition of peasants were very pathetic. Now on the other hand, the artisans were also exploited. Now they were exploited by the merchants who used to compel them to sell their products at cheaper rates. Now the situation was worse for artisan who neither got their share of crops nor they did get adequate pay for their hard work. Now sometimes the official of the East India Company used to give a payment of very small amount to the artisans. That was advance payment. And this was done so that they can prevent the artisans from working for some other European companies or other merchants. So for that they used to give some very small amount of advance payment to them. And when they used to accept that advance payment, now the artisans could not look forward to any other profitable order. So they have to leave their profit if it is there. And like this, the status of an artisan was transformed from an independent worker to a wage worker, a laborer. Now the artisans who were living in the village, they were totally unaware of the outside world. So they were entirely dependent upon the merchant and traders to sell their product in the market. And these merchants and traders used to exploit them fully. Now more demands from merchants mean more capital for raw materials, and like this artisan also came under the grip of money lenders. They used to buy the raw materials, and for raw materials they need money, and they used to borrow that money from the money lenders. Like this they were forced to give up their traditional craft, and they moved to the cities in search of work. Now by the early 18th century, Indian textile, particularly cotton, silk and wool, became very popular in European countries. Now the ever increasing demand of Indian textiles aroused fear and anxiety among the wool and silk makers in England. And they compelled their government to check the inflow of Indian goods. And like this, British government formulated the Calico Act in 1720. According to this act, they banned the use of printed cotton textiles in England. Now, Indian handicrafts and textiles were deprived of their foreign market. Now at the same time, industrial revolution was taking place in Britain, and to produce good quality textiles, the British now took the help of machines. So new machines were invented to facilitate spinning, weaving, dyeing and printing of textiles. So calico printing industry was set up for this. Also spinning jenny was invented by John Kay in 1764. And by using this spinning jenny, a single worker could operate several spindles at one time. Like this, the productivity was increased. Also, it reduced the labor and it saved the time. So the revolution in textile weaving was brought by the invention of the steam engine by Richard Arkwright. Now a bulk of cotton could be woven in one go. This industrial revolution further worsened the plight of Indian weavers. Now they had to compete with the machine-made goods of England in the Europe. Now to check the flow of Indian textile into Britain, the British government increased the tariff rate and custom duties. Now it became very difficult for the Indian weavers to export their textiles to Britain as the custom duties and tariff rates were increased. Like this, the foreign market slipped out of the hand of Indians. Karl Marx, who was an eminent historian, rightly remarked, the British intruders broke up the Indian handloom and destroyed the spinning loom and inundated the very mother country of cotton with cottons. Now the machine-made goods became popular in Britain and Britain market of Africa, America and Europe. And this made thousands of weavers in India jobless and homeless. The Charter Act of 1813 abolished the company's monopoly of trade in India, and this opened the gates of India for all merchants of Britain. Now the merchants came to India not only to buy Indian textiles but to sell their machine-made goods. Also to take away raw materials from India. Like this, the British government enacted laws to facilitate free entry of Britain-made goods into the Indian market. Now the development of railways in India helped the transportation of Britain-manufactured textile to the most remote areas of India. And because of this, there was tremendous blow to the Indian handicrafts industries. Now to check your progress, we have a question. Discuss how modernization and industrialization has changed the rural face of our villages. Now, by the middle of the 19th century, the Indian handicrafts industry was almost ruined. And also it lost the patronage of the local rulers and nawabs, who actually lost their power to the British. Now, new Indian aristocratic class had emerged from the British support. That was in favor of British manufactured goods. So by 1830, Britain made cloth flooded the Indian market. Like this, the Indian textiles and crafts industry that had thrived for centuries and earned universal fame, they were devoid of both national and international markets. Now, many of the weavers were jobless and homeless. The artisans who were jobless and homeless either went to the cities to work as wage laborers or they resorted to loot, dacoity and plunder. Some of them also became agricultural laborers and they further increased the pressure on the land. And some weavers went abroad to find work in the plantations of Africa and South America. In late 19th century, cotton mills were established by the educated Indian class, which was located at Solapur, Bombay, Ahmedabad, Nagpur and Kanpur, Madurai and Solapur emerged as new centers of weaving. Now we have the topic establishment of cotton mills. So the first cotton textile mill was established in India at Bombay in 1854. It was basically a spinning mill, and mills were usually established in those areas which facilitated an easy supply of raw materials. Now, under the patronage of Persian and Gujarati businessmen, about 84 mills were opened in Bombay by 1900, and they had their trade relation mainly with China. Now, in 1861, in Ahmedabad, a mill was established, and in 1862, another mill was established at Kanpur. Now, as there was increase in the demand for labor, the poor weavers, artisans, craftsmen, and agricultural laborers, they got an opportunity so that they can get job in these mills. Now, in the initial stage, the textile industry in India had to compete with the cheap Britain-made textiles. Without any support from the colonial government. Now, the First World War witnessed a decline in the imports from Britain to India, and this gave a tremendous impetus to the growth and development of cotton mills in India. Now, Indian factories were asked to produce cloth and fulfilling military needs. The rise and development of modern industries. So, the establishment of modern industries began in India in second half of 19th century, and the British rulers were not in favor of any industrialized modern India. So, they wanted to preserve India as a source of raw material for their industries in England. For this, they brought policy to de-industrialize India to the fullest. But they were forced to introduce railways, post, telegraph, ports, roads, banking, etc. so that they can maintain administration, they can secure market for European goods and collection of revenue from interior and far off areas. Now, these developments mark the beginning of modern industries in India. Now, the merchants, traders, bankers and moneylenders who actually accumulated lots of wealth, they gave an impetus to right and development of modern industries. So, in 19th century, the decline of arts and handicrafts on one hand and emergence of capitalist class followed by the industrial revolution in England on the other hand paved the way for the rise of new industries in India. Now, to meet the demands of cloth manufacturers and spice traders of England, the officials of East India Company developed plantation industries in India. Now the land was turned into plantations and food crops were replaced by the commercial crops. Indigo, tea, coffee, sugarcane, rubber, jute and cinchona were produced on large scales. Now the main center for indigo plantation was Bihar, where Bihar and Bengal. Tea was grown in Assam, Darjeeling, Bengal and South India. Also, India was famous for spices, coffee and rubber. Now, Kuasji Nanabhai laid the foundation of first cotton textile mill in Bombay in 1854. And after that, many more mills came up. Jute industry was developed mainly in Bengal. Then there was iron and steel industry prior to the British. So before this conquest of India by the British, the iron and steel industry was there in the India. Now this iron and steel was required for making swords, arms, armors and other implements of war for chiefs, nawabs and rulers of India. Now, this South India specialized in the art of making high carbon steel, which was called woods. The swords were made of wood steel. So, they were very sharp, they were having very sharp edges. Now, minute carbon crystals were embedded in iron that gave the swords a flowing water pattern. Now, an account of manufacture of wood steel in Mysore has been given to us by Francis Buchanan. He was a British. He toured Mysore in 1800. And according to him, there were innumerable smelting furnaces all over Mysore. Smelting is actually a process by which metal is obtained from rocks or soil by heating on very high temperature. This process was used for melting the metal and making it in making a new product from it. Now iron was mixed with charcoal in furnaces and then it was put inside small clay pots. And then it was mixed and they were subjected to high temperature so that they can produce steel. So this wood steel was popular in West and Central Asia and was used for making swords. The meaning of this word woods is steel. And it has different names in native languages, like it is called Ukku in Kannada, Hukku in Telugu, Uruku in Tamil and Malayalam. Now Michael Faraday, who was an European scientist, studied the properties of Indian woods for 4 years, from 1818 to 1822. Now, under the British rule, the popularity of wood steel got lost with the advent of British in India and the production totally declined by the mid 19th century. And the reasons were the rulers lost their states to the British and their demand for swords and armors declined sharply. Second, the British imported iron and steel equipments manufactured in their home country. to be used in India. They also forced iron smiths in India to use them in the making of utensils and implements. The British also prevented the people from entering the reserved forest, and this deprived the smelters of wood, which was necessary for the production of charcoal. The furnaces were mostly located in dense forest areas, and that had large reserves of wood, and the officers of company leave high taxes on the smelters for the use of their furnaces. So as a result of this British policies, the smelters of iron and craftsmen both were forced to abandon their craft and search for some other means of livelihood. The Tata Iron and Steel Company, TISCO, was set up at Jamshedpur in 1907 by Jamsetji Tata. It was located on the bank of river Subarnarekha. Later on, more iron and steel factories were set up in Bengal and Mysore. Now, by the coming of railways, the demand of coal was raised, and thus coal mining was also set up as an industry. So you can find that coal mines in Bihar, Bengal and Odisha, who used to supply the coal for railways. Now many more industries were developed, like sugar industry, cement industry, paper industry, heavy chemical industry, match industry and silk yarn industry. So these industries were also developed. But the process of this development of industries in India was very slow. The British took no measures to protect the newly formed industries. The products which were manufactured by the industries still had to face fierce competition from the machine-made goods of Britain, and there was hardly any tariff on the goods being brought to Indian market. Most of the industries were owned by the British, and they utilized the profit of industry for the benefit of their homeland. So if you see, in real sense, the India could not reap the benefits of industrialization. Some of the areas witnessed the development of industries, but other remained totally neglected. And the development was not uniform all over India. So we will start with the topic, the community of weavers. Weavers are actually the people who are skilled in the art of weaving. This profession was usually hereditary, and it was taught by one generation to the next. Now the initial stage of cloth production was spinning, and it was done mostly by the women. Charkha and takli was used in that. After thread was spun on the charkha, it was rolled on the takli. After that, the rolled thread was woven into cloth by the weaver. The work of weaving was done mostly by the men. Now to meet the demands of colored cloth, the thread was dyed by the dyer or the rangrej. So rangrej used to dye the clothes. The chipigars were the people who specialized in block printing. Now the goods which were ready for being sold were first collected in a warehouse, and the warehouse was known as Aurang. Now in early 19th century, the four main I hope you all understood all the topics taught in this video. Thank you.